Morning, church. It's great to see you guys here this morning. Let's stand up and sing together.
Dead. Amen. God is good. Good to see y'all this morning. Welcome to church. Good to see you. I'm glad you found your seats. Look around the room. A couple of you are off. You're like, this is weird, you know. But hey, I see most of you, you landed right where we left you. So it's good to see you. Good to see you this morning. Hey, when you came in this morning, hopefully you found a bulletin was handed to you and a welcome card. Want to encourage you this morning. Let us know that you're here. Let us know if there's anything going on in your world that we can partner in prayer with you. We can petition the Lord for you. We can bring in prayer for you. And you can drop this card in the offering baskets as you leave today. And if today's your first time with us, we're thrilled that you came with us today. You can let us know. And we just want to say, hey, welcome. Glad you're here. We are going to take offering up like we had been across the street. So as you get ready to leave today, if you haven't left your offering, you can drop that in the black baskets as you leave today. We won't be passing the plates. We're going to continue to put those at the door, all right? We're going to continue to sing. We're going to continue to worship our God who is good. And we hope you continue to lift your voice with us. Would you pray with me? So, Father, right now, we're so thankful to be able to be together to worship you. We don't take for granted that we have this freedom. We have this opportunity to do so. Father, we know that there's some who aren't here with us today, and we pray a blessing upon them. Father, meet with them. Show them that you're with them and what they're going through. And Father, as we do sing, as we lift our voices, as we make this melody, as we think these thoughts, God, I pray that you'll be honored by them. Whether it's a new song, whether it's an old song, God, we get to lift this praise to you, and we know, God, it pleases you when we do so. So that's why we do it. We worship you now. In Jesus' name. Amen.
As we've been reading through the book of Daniel, one of the things you'll really notice is it seems like even though Daniel and his friends were faithful to God, like throughout the whole time, that bad stuff kept happening to them. I mean, particularly because of their faithfulness. And so we come to this morning, we're going to have the same story that we've heard before. But in the midst of everything, Daniel and his friends were faithful. They trusted God in the middle of all the difficult times, the storms, the things that came their way. They were praising God at every turn. They were praying to God at every turn. And so when we worship this morning, I want us to be reminded of, think through those stories. Think through the difficult times that people faced and were faithful and God brought them through, okay? Because that's the kind of people, that's the kind of heart that we need to have, the heart that overcomes because we're trusting and leaning into Jesus. So let's continue to sing about that this morning. When peace like a river floods in death my way, when
sin, I
Father in heaven, we are just so thankful that we can always count on you. You're a God who is faithful. You're firm. You don't change even when times change, that you are always loving and always good. Father, we just pray that our hearts can lean into you as we learn more about the kind of people you're asking us to be. We love you. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You can be seated, church.
It is nice to be back. Today I'd like to talk about hope. And if you want to stop and think, you know, when we moved over to the sanctuary, I'm not sure that we always or even thought that we would be back. I think we all hoped, but maybe that was not a hope. Maybe it wasn't as confident as it should have been. The confident hope is what I like to talk about. The word hope, as frequently used today, is often at odds with the Bible, how the Bible uses the word hope. Hope is an undervalued quality of the Christian life, its ability to focus our faith and bond together. We talk about something they would love to have happen, is what a lot of us kind of use the definition of, but we don't really think it will ever happen. We hear the expression today, one could only hope. The New Testament uses the word hope in a sense of confident expectation of something good. It is never used in a fearful expectation. Romans 15:13. May the God of hope fill you with all the joy and peace as you trust in him, so that you may overflow by the power of the Holy Spirit. We should boast in hope of the glory of God. For the one in Christ, there is no doubt, hope hinges on the character of the one in whom hope is placed. In Christ, we have peace, grace, hope. Paul urges unity in the body of Christ through the sacrificial example of Jesus and the marvels that Jesus' servanthood has brought hope. Paul prays that God's diverse people now are in Christ may overflow with hope. And as we meet once again in our sanctuary, this sanctuary, to partake of the Lord's Supper, we should reclaim the element of hope inherent in that hope. When Jesus instituted communion, he emphasized that it is both a celebration of his presence with us and the looking backward and forward. It is a remembrance of his death until he comes. Christian hope is the embodiment of the assurance as we look steadfast at Jesus, that neither his suffering nor ours is in vain, that servanthood leads to glory, and that death is not final. Let us pray. Lord, hope. Always hope. Lord, we know that you died, and we know that you're coming back. There's no hope to it. You are coming back. Lord, may the God of hope fill you with all the joy and peace as you trust in him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. That is Romans 15:13. Lord, thank you for that word. In your son's name we pray. Amen. As communion is brought forward, please take your cup from the tray and take that as you fill. And when you're done with your cup, yeah.
You brought your Bibles, and I hope that you did. Go ahead and open them to Daniel chapter 6. The Old Testament book of Daniel chapter 6. And if you didn't bring a Bible with you, you're in luck. We're in a pew now, and there's a seat in front of you that has one in the seat back in front of you. A little black book, you can pull it out. Page 618 will take you to Daniel chapter 6. We're continuing in our summer sermon series in which we're digging into this Old Testament book from the prophet Daniel. And this book, we're discovering stories of courage from some pretty ordinary people whom God used to do some extraordinary things. All the while, God's people are living as exiles in a godless society. And we've been learning from this book of Daniel because we recognize in 21st century America today, society around us is increasingly abandoning faith in God, and they're turning away oftentimes from God. So far, as we've studied Daniel, we've learned about Daniel and his three friends, all of whom were taken as captives from their family living in Jerusalem. Their city was destroyed, their temple was ransacked, and they were thrown into this training camp of such to learn how to serve the king of Babylon. And from their stories, we are encouraged to stand, to take a stand for the things that matter most. One of the lessons we learned about was with Daniel and his three friends who were persecuted for not bowing down and worshiping this giant golden statue of King Nebuchadnezzar because they believed only the living God was worthy of their worship. And we saw how God rescued them from the fiery furnace because they had the faith to stand firm. Another lesson we learned from this book was Daniel, when he had the faith to stand up and to speak up to the king for God because he was oppressing the poor and he was not living in a way that honors God. And we watched how God stood with Daniel when he got the king's attention. Now this morning we're going to be in Daniel chapter 6 and we're going to watch Daniel standing strong and with supernatural kind of strength that can only come in a long-term developed faith-driven relationship with the living God. And my encouragement to you this morning, church family, is that you have that kind of relationship with the living God that you have faith in and that you walk with the one true God who wants to walk through life with you. I want to give you kind of my big idea on the front end, and then we'll kind of dig into this thought throughout the rest of our time together. The thing I want you to take home today is this very simple yet profound lesson, and that is when you stand for God, you can rest confidently in His strength. I want you to really dig down deep and hold on to this, and so I'm going to ask you to say it out loud with me, because I think if you read it and you say it, you're employing two different senses, and so maybe you'll take more of it home with you. So would you read this out loud with me? When you stand for God, you can rest confidently in His strength. Moment of honesty this morning. We live in the greatest nation on planet Earth, and we have these incredible freedoms. We are blessed as Americans with a freedom to exercise our faith in any way we choose or we please. Why, we can sing when we want to sing. We can sing what we want to sing. We can come together when we want to come together. We can come together where we want to come together. We can meet in a church building. We can meet in a gym. We can meet in a park if we want to, and we don't have to ask anyone's permission to do so. We can open our Bibles, read from our Bibles, believe what our Bible says. We can pray together. We can gather together. We have freedoms to do all of that. And we also have the freedom to not do any of that if we so choose, because that's the country we live in. We have these freedoms to practice our faith however we choose. But let me ask you a question. What happens when those freedoms that we have to express our faith stands in the face of opposition? What happens? What do we do when our practicing of our faith, which we take for granted so often, stands in opposition and is being threatened by somebody wanting to take that freedom away? What do you do when the very freedom you have to come to church on a Sunday or to read your Bible in your home or pray with your family is being threatened to take away? Now, we acknowledge that we live in America and we have these freedoms, and it's written into our Constitution to maintain these freedoms, and it's really not the threat we're facing right now. But there may come a time when what we're talking about, this real persecution of our worship of God, this legal opposition of freedom to practice our faith, may stand directly before us. What do we do? This is common in countries all around our world. What do they do? And while this may not be the case yet today for us, what may be very real in some of our lives right this very moment is an abuse of your personal faith. Let me give you a few examples of what I'm talking about. What do you do when your boss tells you you must work on Sunday or else you lose your job? You have to come to work. You can't go to church. I need you here. And so you don't come to work, you don't have a job. What do you do? What do you do, and I've seen this a lot with students and working with students in student ministry, what do you do when you're a student and you have faith in Jesus, but your parents don't support your coming to church, and so they go about punishing you by keeping you home and not letting you go to church? We have students in our youth group that face that on a weekly basis. What do you do, husband, what do you do, wife, when your spouse, unchurched spouse, nags you for wanting to come to a Bible study or to come to church? I know some of you are walking in that place right now. What do you do when you attempt to make a decision according to what you know is true in the Bible? You just want to be obedient to what the Bible says, and yet it is met with opposition from those that you love most. What do you do when your biblical convictions are met with cultural opposition, when what you believe to be truth is directly confronted by societal pressure to change? Every one of us are dealing with that right now. What do you do? Well, this morning I want to take you to Daniel chapter 6, and we're going to get some help. And I believe that when we read from this place, we're going to find some strength for our faith. And when you look at Daniel chapter 6, you probably recognize what's going on. You probably heard this story before. It's one you grew up learning in Vacation Bible School. Our kids learned about it just a couple of weeks ago this summer at our Bible school. Maybe you learned it in Sunday school. It's Daniel and the lion's den. Remember that story? Quite familiar. And so what I want to do this morning is bring a little context to this story, and then we're going to talk about what standing strong in the middle of severe opposition looks like. So let's pray together, then we'll dig into Daniel chapter 6, and we'll study that together. Pray with me. So Father, we have our Bibles open, and we also open our hearts and our minds, and we pray that you'll teach us this morning how to stand with faith and rest in your strength. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, Daniel chapter 6, beginning in verse 1. Says this. Now it pleased Darius to appoint 120 satraps to rule throughout the kingdom, with three administrators over them, one of whom was Daniel. The satraps were made accountable to them so that the king might not suffer loss. Now Daniel so distinguished himself among the administrators that the satraps had, by his exceptional qualities, that the king planned to set him over the whole kingdom. We'll hit pause for just a moment. Right off the bat, you might notice that Daniel is serving under a different king. For the last few weeks, we've been studying in Daniel, and we've encountered this king of Babylon, King Nebuchadnezzar, right? Right here, we got a new king. Well, just by context, so you understand, Daniel chapter 5 ended with the Babylonian Empire losing a war with the Persian Empire. And so now a new king reigns. And this new king is named Darius. And now Daniel, we think, is probably in his mid-80s or so. He's been serving for a long time. And that's where we pick up in Daniel chapter 6. Daniel chapter 6, read about this new king. And then just a little history about King Darius, king of Persia. He was an administrative genius. And that's evident by the structure that he implemented over his vast kingdom. He divided the kingdom into 120 districts with a ruler inserted in each one of them. And then he placed three administrators to oversee each of those districts. You see, Darius is a delegator. The king, you know, he didn't have email, so he could stay in contact with his various districts all over the place. He couldn't have his district supervisors, these satraps, call him, you know, from hundreds of miles away to give a report. He didn't have that. There wasn't like instant messaging where they could keep in contact if there was some sort of rebellion in place. And so he had administrators who would regularly check in and could come and give him a report. He delegated oversight of his kingdom to these three supervisors. And one of them, one of the key administrators that met regularly with the king, is our boy Daniel. You remember Daniel stood out at the beginning in Daniel chapter 1 when he and his three friends were brought to Babylon. He has now served as a king's advisor for nearly seven decades. And he's advanced through the ranks of government. And now Daniel is working as the number two in command over the whole kingdom. What looks like a great day for Daniel, what appears to be a promotion of sorts, actually causes a whole lot of trouble for him. See, there's other two administrators serving next to him, and they get jealous, and they want to develop a plan to try to bring Daniel down. Look at verse 4. It says, "At this, the administrators and the satraps tried to find grounds for charges against Daniel in his conduct of governmental affairs, but they were unable to do so. They could find no corruption in him because he was trustworthy and neither corrupt nor negligent." You see right here, Daniel is doing his job. He is serving well. And the other two administrators working right along next to him, they get jealous. They want to bring Daniel down. And this is something I want you to keep in mind, church. When you are driven in your faith in God, like Daniel, you will stand out in ways that God wants you to. And if you're willing to stand up for what matters most, you're going to find out that God is willing to put you in a place where he will let you shine and he will let you serve in an excellent way. But let me tell you something that inevitably happens when you take your stand for God. And you may want to remember this, or you may want to write this down for later. If you're willing to take a stand for God, when God raises you up, expect people to try to tear you down. It's going to happen. Inevitably, when God raises you up, there are going to be others around you that can't handle it. They can't handle your success. They can't handle your promotion. They can't handle when God is doing something excellent in your life, and they will try to come and bring you down. I don't know for Daniel why this happened. Maybe it was because he was a foreigner. He wasn't the local boy. He wasn't one of us. And so we didn't want him to be promoted above us. As he moved further and faster up the corporate ladder than everyone else, they just couldn't handle what was going on in his life, and they wanted to bring him back down to their size. I don't know, maybe he's working harder than everybody else wanted to work. You've probably seen this before in your places of work. If you invest your time and you invest your energy more and beyond what everyone else is doing, they all start talking about you like, who does he think he is? What does she think she's doing? And they want to bring you back down because they don't want to invest that kind of effort. They don't want to put that kind of work in. I don't know why Daniel's getting promoted for the good he's doing. Here's what I can tell you, though. It's not just by his own work ethic that he's being promoted. He's being promoted by God. We've seen this play out since chapter 1. God is sovereign and involved in everything that's happening in this story. And so as God promotes Daniel, the other two candidates lost the promotion, and they're looking for ways to bring Daniel down. And herein lies a problem with cultural Christianity. This brand of Christianity that we've been talking about that's going around our country right now, this popular brand of religion that selects certain things we like but rejects the biblical truth that we find too difficult to hang on to. What we choose to believe, the things that are easy and convenient for our lives, we hang on to, but the rest of it we kind of toss to the side because it doesn't jive with the way I think life ought to be going. You know, folks that hang on to this kind of theology will say things like, you know what, my God loves me, and so nothing bad should ever happen to me. Or, I'm serving my God and I shouldn't face any opposition. If I'm doing what my God wants me to do, then I shouldn't have people coming against me. God is for me, then who can be against me? I shouldn't be facing a hard time. We'll take certain scriptures we find to be helpful, if we think they're good for us, and we'll build those into our theology, but we'll reject those things that kind of counter our way of living because it doesn't fit. And we know the Bible just doesn't give us that kind of religion. That's not what we're talking about when we open our Bibles. You see, we've said this before, and we'll say it often, because nowhere in the Bible are we ever promised a good and easy life just because you came to Jesus. In fact, Jesus himself said in John 16, verse 33, in this world, you will have trouble. If you follow Jesus, if you do life God's way, you're going to face opposition. It's going to stand before you, and you're going to have to stand because that's what Jesus faced. He was nailed to a cross. Don't think we won't face anything less. See, the truth is, as Christians, we're living in a world that stands between two kingdoms. We live in the middle. We're living in the world, and on one side we have heaven, and on the other side we have hell. And we're living in this world in the middle, but we're serving a God that's not of this world. He's of heaven. And we're facing an enemy that's not of this world. He's of hell. And we are living in this middle, in this space of tension, where there's a constant battle between these two kingdoms waging war for our souls. That's what's talked about in Ephesians chapter 6. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 12 says this, "For our struggle is not against flesh and blood." Let me just kind of let you know, as we move further into Daniel, we're going to discover this truth that we're living in a world that feels very physical, where we feel very physical things. But as Christians, we understand that this is also a spiritual place. And the American society and even cultural Christianity has lost this understanding that there is a real spiritual battle being waged in this world right now. And as we enter into this understanding of what's happening in our world, we're going to have to know that we can't just battle these things physically, that there is a spiritual way of battling these things. And that's what Ephesians 6 is all about. Ephesians 6 pairs so nicely with the book of Daniel that it's so helpful. So he continues, Paul says, "Our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but it's against the rulers, against the authorities, and against the powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces." There it is. Of evil in the heavenly realms. See, we're in this middle spot. That's where the world is right now. This is our lives. On either side of us is a kingdom waging war spiritually. You get that? You understand that? See, we must recognize the spiritual forces that are at work in our lives. And Paul will go on to write in Ephesians chapter 6 all about the spiritual warfare and how you're to wage war in this spiritual war. If you feel this tension of being in this spiritual war, you need to read Ephesians 6 sometime. It tells you how you battle in the spiritual war. It talks about putting on the armor of God. And it's this armor that we put upon ourselves spiritually that gives us the courage to take our stand like Daniel is in Daniel chapter 6. And this spiritual war that we're fighting, it can't be fought with flesh and blood. It can't be fought with weapons of the world. It has to be fought with spiritual source and spiritual strength that only God can give. You see, when we're moving the kingdom of God forward as a church, like he's called us to, we can always expect resistance from the prince of darkness. You can always expect that God's enemy is going to stand before you with real opposition. And oftentimes, the prince of darkness is going to work not just spiritually, but he's going to use people in our midst, even well-meaning people who we know and love, and they're going to stand against us. I'm here to tell you, when God raises you up, expect people to tear you down, because God wants to move you forward, but the enemy does not. And we're living in this spiritual moment. We're going to hang on to this thought in Ephesians 6, and we'll come back to this thought over and over again in our text today. So Daniel, he's standing out. Daniel is standing up. And Daniel is standing strong. And sure enough, there's some opposition standing against him. Some of you may be experiencing this kind of opposition in your life too. The other two administrators, they're like, hey, we got to stop Daniel. And so I just kind of summarize what's happening in Daniel's life. They knew Daniel's faith was so fundamental to his life that his faith was so ingrained into his identity that his faith was the one shot they had in getting him in trouble. They knew they couldn't practice what they would do with anyone else. They couldn't frame him because he was so good. He was so righteous, but they couldn't. The only way they could get him was through his faith. They knew that Daniel would betray his king before he would betray his God. And so they attacked him where it hurt most. Remember the story? They went before the king and they said, "Hey, king, we got this great idea. I think this will please you a whole lot. Why don't you issue this law that says over the next 30 days, no one can pray to any god except you. And if they pray to any other god, O king, then they'll be thrown into the lion's den." You know what this did for the king? Oh, King Darius, he's like other kings. This stroked his ego. You know, kings are vulnerable to pride. Oftentimes they wanted to deify themselves. This was common among ancient kings. They wanted other people to think they were as strong and as mighty as God. They knew they weren't God, but they wanted other people to treat them like they were a god. And so King Darius, he goes along with this plan, and there's now a law that stands. If you worship or pray to any other god besides King Darius, you're going to be fed to the lions. And when Daniel finds out about this law, what do you think he does? Well, you know the story. You know it doesn't faze him. You know he goes right in and he prays anyway. Let's get something straight this morning. Just because the government allows it doesn't make it right. You cannot legislate theology. See, Daniel, he's loyal to the king. He's the king's right-hand man so long as it never contradicts his own faith in God. And this is what works for us too. This is still our way of living as Christians today. See, we talked about this about a year ago when we were talking about kingdom politics. As God's people, God has given us a mandate in Scripture to obey those in authority who have been placed over us. Only insofar as their authority does not command us to disobey God's word. See, we have this understanding that we are Christians first, and then we're Americans. Like, we have this patriotism. It's great to love America. We love what God has given us here in this country. We should fight for these freedoms that we have, and yet we recognize that our first allegiance isn't to our country. It is to our God. And when our country, if ever our country, calls us to disobey God's word, then we disobey our country. That's what Daniel shows us to do. The king's edict was that, Daniel, you don't pray to anyone else except the king. But Daniel saw this as a direct violation of God's word, the first of the Ten Commandments that say, you shall have no other gods before me. And so what does Daniel do? Well, look at verse 10. Daniel chapter 6, verse 10 tells us, now when Daniel learned that the decree had been published, he went home to his upstairs room where the windows were opened toward Jerusalem. Three times a day he got down on his knees and he prayed, giving thanks to his God, get this, just as he had done before. I love that phrase. Just as he had done before. Now, let's keep something in mind. Daniel, he is living in the midst of his story. Daniel had never gone to vacation Bible school. He doesn't know how this story ends. He doesn't know what's going to happen here in the end. All he knows is the consequences of his actions. And he knows there is a law in place. If you pray to any other god but King Darius, you're fed to the lions. And he knows, if I pray to the one true God, I will be fed to the lions. He has no idea that God is going to rescue him. He simply had to make a decision. How did Daniel have such audacious faith to pray anyway? How does Daniel know? What is Daniel thinking? How is he willing to trust in God no matter what? I'll tell you. He prays just as he had always done before. That's how he has such strong faith. This was second nature to Daniel. His default response is always to pray. He's done it three times a day for as long as he can remember. He prayed to God this morning. He prayed to God three times yesterday. He's done this every day for the last 70 some odd years he's been in this place. He always prays. And so that's what he does when something happens. He prays. You want to talk to somebody who is facing some incredibly overwhelming trial that you could not imagine facing in your own life. And you think to yourself, how are you keeping your faith about you? How are you walking through this with such strength? I tell you what they'll tell you every single time. I promise you, this is exactly what they're going to say. They're going to say, I'm praying just like I've always prayed. Is this overwhelming me? Yes. But is God still with me? Absolutely. I'm going to keep reading my Bible and believing it. I'm going to keep praying and trusting God. I'm going to keep worshiping God and going to church. This isn't going to shake me because I'm going to do what I've always done before. Those of you who have these like shock moments, like, oh no, I'm going to face this trial. I better run back to God. That's hard for you. I'm glad you're running back to God, but that's still hard for you. What do? We keep it default. We keep doing what we've always done before. We keep walking with the Lord. This is why this is a habit for us. Every Sunday, we're together. Every day, we're honoring the Lord. Every day, we're reading the Bible. Every day, we're praying to God. This is our nature. And then when life happens, when spiritual war comes at us, guess what? We do what we've always done before. That's what Daniel's doing. That's how Daniel's living. See, I believe this is a non-negotiable requirement if you're going to stand strong. And this is something I want you to kind of think about and I want you to weigh in. You're going to do what you've always done before. Here's what you're going to find out. Kneeling to pray gives you the strength to stand. How am I going to stand in the face of opposition? Well, you're going to first kneel before God, and he will give you the strength to stand. See, our first response to trials should never be to panic. Just walked out of the doctor's office. Panic. Oh no, what do I do? Daniel's default was, I'm going to go just like I do every day. I'm going to kneel before the Lord. Just got bad news from work. Ah, what do we do? Not Daniel. He's going to go into the same place, kneel at the same window that he has knelt at three times a day for as long as he can remember, and he's praying to the Lord. What are you going to do when you face opposition? What are you going to do when times are changing? Doesn't matter. I'm going to do what I've always done before. My first reaction is not to panic. My first reaction is always to pray. There's a promise that I cling to in Hebrews chapter 4, verse 16. It's a promise that you ought to commit to memory because it's so powerful to strengthen your faith, to remind you that your default response is always to pray. The Hebrews writer writes in Hebrews 4, verse 16, it says, "Let us then approach the throne of grace with confidence, so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help us in our time of need." Let us approach the throne of grace. This is a picture of entering into God's throne room in heaven whenever we need to bring to the throne of God whatever is on our hearts, whatever is bothering us. You see, dear Christian, we have access to the very creator and sustainer of the universe. We get to have an audience with the God who cares about our intimate needs in our life. We can petition the God of the universe anytime. He hears the cries of those who humble themselves before him. We can pray. We can talk to God, and he hears us. He delights to move mountains for us because he loves us. We can pray. Why do we not make that our first default answer? Make that a daily habit. Notice that Daniel doesn't just go about announcing his prayers to the public. He's not saying, hey, God's going to pray anyway. He's not butting the system. He's not confronting the opposition. He's not going on Facebook and writing some condemning post against the government. No, he is just quietly living by faith, doing what he's always done. He doesn't need to make the announcement. He doesn't need to cast it to the world. He's just quietly living about his faith, trusting in God. He could stand before people because he had knelt before God. So my brother and sister, when life overwhelms you, Seek God in prayer. When life gives you more than you can stand, then get on your knees before God in prayer, and He will give you the strength to stand up. Unsure how to handle the changing times? Then get alone with God, and He will carry that with you. See, your part is only your part. You are only responsible to do what you know is right. And when you do, I wish I could tell you that when you do what is right in the eyes of God, that He will always work it out in the way you want it to. But I can't tell you that. If I were in Daniel's shoes, and maybe you too, we'd probably pray something like, oh God, I've been faithful to you for a long time. I've been coming to this place and praying, so please don't let the lions eat me. I'd probably want to be real with God in that moment, you know, like save me from this. And that's understandable. But we can't always count on God answering our prayers in the ways that we want to. See, throughout history, we read about people who have as much faith in God as Daniel. And for whatever reason, God doesn't rescue them. See, we're not talking about a Disney movie with this happily ever after ending. We're talking about real life with a sovereign God whose ways are higher than our ways, whose understanding is beyond our comprehension, whose plans don't have to make sense to us. And so standing strong is not immune to opposition. Doesn't mean there's no resistance, and it doesn't mean there's no pain. Standing strong means God is for you, and He is going to walk through this with you, whatever may happen. So standing strong, Daniel is standing strong for God. And there's people out to tear him down. And Daniel's done what he's always done. He kneels before God, which gives him the strength to stand up some more. And now standing with a renewed faith, Daniel is sentenced to die. He's prayed. He's guilty of breaking the king's command. So he faces the consequences. He's thrown into the den of lions. And don't mistake this. These aren't those little furball lion cubs with smiles on their faces that you remember on the flannel graphs in Sunday school. No, these are flesh-eating. These are ferocious lions with big teeth, and they're hungry. And so now in the face of opposition, what does Daniel do? When you read the story, it's the same thing we should all do when we face our oppressors. Daniel doesn't fight it. We don't read in the text that Daniel goes kicking and screaming. He's not resisting. He doesn't fight. No, Daniel simply remains faithful. So church, when you stand for God, you can rest confidently in His strength. And when you face the opposition, you don't have to fight it. Just remain faithful to the Lord. See, too often we feel like we ought to fight back. Oh, you insult my God, I'm going to take you to trial. You silence my rights, I'm going to push back. And listen, there's a place for fighting back, and there's a time to go to court. But ultimately, we have to recognize, dear Christian, that legal and political victories are not the end result we're seeking. Ultimately, as Christians, we are seeking God's glory for all of eternity. And so that's what we're pursuing here. Remember, our struggle, it's not against flesh or blood. This is a spiritual battle. And that won't be won in the courts, and a spiritual battle won't be won in the Capitol. And I'm not suggesting we just lie down in like a doormat and let people trample all over us. What I'm saying is when you take your stand for God, you can rest confidently in His strength, and He will work out how this plays out. I'll never forget for as long as I live, June of 2015, when during a Bible study in Charleston, South Carolina, a coward behind a barrel walked into a church and murdered 9 Christians studying the Bible, including their pastor. You probably remember this. It made national headlines. In response to these killings, the church in Charleston came together. And they sought the Lord. And publicly they forgave the killer. And they came together that Sunday morning in the room where their loved ones had been shot and killed. And they worship God together. My first response is, how on earth did they muster the strength to do that? How do they do what seems so unthinkable? How do they forgive? How do they love? How do they come together in that way when they're hurting so much? I can tell you. It's because they did what they've always done. This was their default. They were defaulting to obeying God's word no matter what. And the scripture says that you forgive those who have sinned against you because you've been forgiven of much. And the scripture says to pray for your persecutors. And the scripture says to give thanks in all circumstances. And so as hard as it was, that's what they did, because this is what they've done. This is what they've always done. They did just as they've done before. My church family, when you take your stand for God, you can rest confidently in His strength. Your opposition, it's God's opposition. Your battles, they're God's battles. You can rest confidently that He's got your back, and you can keep standing with Him. Remember, Daniel didn't know the end of the story when he was living in the middle of the story. He didn't know that one day his testimony would be the topic of a sermon on courage and faith. He had no idea that one day Bible classes will be using him as the lesson. All he knew was that for the last 80 years of his life, God had been faithful to him. And so no matter what, he was going to remain faithful to God. So he was fed to the lions. And the next morning, King Darius came running to the opening of the lion's den. And in Daniel chapter 6, verse 20, the king came near the den and he called out to Daniel in an anguished voice and he said, Daniel, servant of the living God, has your God whom you serve continually been able to rescue you from the lions? We don't know what Daniel was doing that night with the lions in the den. All we know is what didn't happen. They didn't eat him because the power of God shut the mouths of the lions. Listen to Daniel's response in verse 22. Daniel said, my God sent his angel, and he shut the mouths of the lions. They have not hurt me because I was found innocent in God's sight. Nor have I done anything wrong before you, O king. And the king was overjoyed and gave orders to lift Daniel out of the den. And when Daniel was lifted from the den, no wound was found on him because he had trusted in his God. Church, when you stand for God, you too can rest confidently in His strength. So let me ask you this morning, what lions, metaphorically speaking, do you face? What opposition is standing in your way? Whatever it is, I want you to remember that when God raises you up, there's going to be people there to tear you down. And when your lions begin to roar, you can kneel before God in prayer, for that's where you'll find your strength to stand again. And when God has strengthened you, rather than preparing to fight back, just set your focus on remaining faithful to God. And if you do what is right, the God of our salvation, you can trust Him with the results. Let's pray together. Father, we're amazed by this story in Daniel. We see how he is strengthened to stand. And his strength, it seems so extraordinary, but God, we see that it came about in such ordinary means of grace. You have given us, your church today, the same means of grace. As you gave Daniel, you invite us to pray to you. You invite us to come to you, to trust you, to put on the spiritual armor that Paul writes about in Ephesians 6. You've given us the same means of grace to take our stand. And too often we are guilty of standing in this place and in this time, fighting a spiritual battle with means of flesh and blood. I pray, dear God, that you will teach us. Take on a spiritual strength that, God, you've promised us in your word. Father, for those of us right now that are facing real struggle, those of us whose faith is really feeling a sense of abuse, trial, God, I pray that you will meet them right now and strengthen them. May we have the courage to kneel before you, O God, to receive the strength from you to stand. So thankful, God, that we don't go through any of these moments alone. But you're always with us. We can be confident in that. Give us that strength now, we pray. In the precious name of Jesus. Amen. Well, church, I want to invite you to stand, and we're going to sing one more song. And as we do, if you're walking through something right now that you just struggle to face alone, I want you to know you're not alone, first of all. God of all creation stands with you. If you want your brothers and sisters in the church, you just want somebody to come alongside of you in the midst of this moment, I want you to know that right now, during this next song, I'd be willing to pray with you. If you want to do that, then as we sing, you just come down and meet me. I'll pray with you right now. Don't walk through these seasons alone. Let's take this moment right now and let's praise our God who's with us.
Oh,
pray with me? Father, right now, whatever burdens on our heart, whatever opposition we're facing, whatever lions are breathing down our necks, God, we recognize you are stronger, that our circumstances are no match to the power of God. And as we pray to you, God, we are not praying with conditions that we want you or are asking you to do it our way. But God, we do pray with faith in your sovereign will, knowing, God, that you are going to do what is ultimately best. That is what we understand the word to tell us. And that is where our faith lies. Jesus had to go through the cross to be able to defeat a grave. And there's crosses that we're going to bear that's going to get us to that moment of eternal life as well. And so, Father, we pray for strength to trust in you through it. May we leave here today with stronger faith than we came here with. May we understand that there is a community here who walks with us through these trials. And we are never alone. Thank you, Father, for all these blessings. We praise you for them in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. It is so good to be here today. Amen. Glad that you're here today. A couple things I want to send you home with. Again, if you didn't pick up a bulletin when you came in, make sure you grab one. It's got some important things happening in the life of the church. Namely, I want to call your attention to August 11th. That is our outreach event that we do for our back-to-school season. It's called the Back-to-School Bash, and it's a great afternoon of fun for the kids in the community. It's a great way for us to build some community with the folks in our community. We'll see hundreds of kids from our community coming to hang out and eat some food and play games. It's a good time for us to introduce them and invite them to our weekly kids programming that begins that following Wednesday night. Now, we need some volunteers to make this happen, and so we'd love for you to take a 30-minute time slot to serve, to help out, play games with kids, serve some food. If you'll see Miss Kay Hicks on your way out today, she'll get you signed up. She'll get you a place to serve. It's a small investment you can make into building our kids' ministry here for the church this fall, all right? I also want to let you know that we're starting a new reading plan on prayer. Just what we were talking about, we need some scripture to help us strengthen our prayer life. So for the next 2 weeks, as we finish up the book of Daniel, Daniel took a little longer than I was originally planning, but that's okay. As for the next 2 weeks, as we finish up Daniel, we're going to go through and read some powerful prayers from the scriptures. And you can model your praying after some of these prayers. If you want one of these prayer cards, you can pick one up at one of the tables by the offering baskets as you leave. We're going to continue to send out those text blasts throughout the week to remind you. And yeah, that's great. So it's been good today. It's been good to hang out with you guys. We'll see you right here again next Sunday. God bless you. Love you guys.